Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the. Good morning.
Oh, crap.
Welcome to the Unitarian Church of Edmonton. My name is Brandie Moller-Reid. My pronouns are she and her, and I am the service leader for this morning. As Unitarian Universalists, we are bound together by a common set. Of beliefs, but our promise to support one another in our individual searches for truth and meaning, guided by our principles and drawing from many sources. We do hope you will feel welcome here. Whatever you believe or do not believe, whoever you love, however you understand family, whatever your age, race, or ability, you are welcome here. We invite you to join us in a journey of free thought, spiritual questing, and justice making for as long as you feel comfortable doing so. We extend a special welcome to any visitors this morning, and we ask you to please join us after the service for conversation. We begin our gathering acknowledging that we are located on Treaty 6 territory. We respect the histories, languages, and cultures of First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and First Peoples of Canada, whose presence continues to enrich our vibrant community. Our community extends beyond Sunday morning gatherings. We have a monthly newsletter available online, and you can join our virtual community on Facebook and Twitter, or X, I guess, to keep up to date on happenings in our extended community. Now, we can prepare our hearts for worship. Let us let go just for a time of the everyday world. We will quiet ourselves, our phones and devices, and we will create a space in this hour to simply be together. In the spirit of life and love, we gather. And before we start our service, we'll have some announcements. I believe there are at least three. Declan?
Good morning. My name is Declan Kiley. You may have heard last week or on the newsletter that me and my friend Paula are setting up a movie night in the church. So on the 26th, so this Friday, we are going to be watching The Holdovers right here in the sanctuary. And I think that we are starting around 5:30. There is more information in the newsletter, or you can talk to me after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, Declan. Andrew?
Hi there, my name's Andrew Mills, and I'm the guy on the roof. just over a week ago, the roofers started, and they're already about three quarters done of the center section. So just the strip over the offices is all that's left to be done on the center roof, and they hope to start on the smaller roof, the east roof, on Monday. So it's just going really, really much faster than I expected. They got the first layer done on Thursday, and I came in yesterday and they worked on Saturday and they got the second layer done over three quarters of the roof. So we're gonna start putting ceiling tiles back in and try to get our church back into its regular alignment. And so very excited about that. There's still an opportunity to donate to the roof though. There is a easel out in the lobby which has envelopes on it, and you can make a special contribution to the roof fund. Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Try it again. I have them trained. That's why they did that.
Yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Music to my ears. Good morning. My name is the Reverend Rosemary Morrison, and it is my pleasure and honor to serve this congregation, this Unitarian Church of Edmonton. Some of you have probably seen that I thought I had COVID. I do not. I have a bit of a flu that took my lungs out for a couple of days, so I'm standing back, and I'm a little short of breath, so bear with me. I have two things I'd like to say. First of all, I'd like to welcome Danylo Budenko and his family. Danylo, could you stand up, please? Thank you, and this is Danylo, and he is going to be giving us some music today. Thank you, Danylo. and he brought with him two rows of folks. So that's awesome, awesome. The other thing I wanted to say was, you can sit down. Thanks, hon. Thank you. The other thing I wanted to say was that a week Monday will be the second or maybe third last you use on tap, Brewster's, anytime after 5:30 for a meal or a beverage and for conversation and to get to know one another better. So a week this coming Monday is our annual or our monthly Brewster's gathering, UU's on tap. And I think that's it. Anyone else?
I have one.
And you have one, okay.
Yeah.
Just a real quick announcement. Last night, we had our Dragging Youth Show here in the building. As many of you know, we host those every month. But last night, it was actually a fundraiser for UCE. So they raised just over $860 with the Dragging Youth Show. And last month, they held a bingo, which was also another $800. So thank you very much to Dragging Youth Shows for a donation of about $1,600 towards our youth, or our roof, sorry. And now we will go into our prelude by Danylo, The Little Prince. Thank you. That was lovely. Now we'll move into our chalice lighting. I've asked Jeff Bezance to help us with that. This one is called On Ubuntu by Bishop Desmond Tutu. One of the sayings in our country is Ubuntu, the essence of being human. Ubuntu speaks particularly about the fact that you can't exist as a human being in isolation. It speaks about our interconnectedness. You can't be human all by yourself. And when you have this quality, Ubuntu, you are known for your generosity. We think of ourselves far too frequently as just individuals, separated from one another, whereas you are connected, and what you do affects the whole world. When you do it well, it spreads out. It is for the whole of humanity. It's going to be stubborn for you, Jeff. There we go. Thank you. Now we'll have our opening hymn, number 134, Our World is One World. The text will appear on the screen behind me. Please stand as you are willing and able to join in singing hymn 134. Now is our time for all ages. We have a story, The Curious Garden by Peter Brown, and I believe Karen is going to read it for us.
I was very happy. Beautiful illustrations that you can follow along with. There once was a...
Thank you, Karen. I think story time is one of my favorite times we have in this church. And now it's time for the service leader reflection. Moi. So last month, I was privileged to stand before you and talk about transformation, in which I mostly focused on self-awareness, self-growth, to transform into a happy, healthy, and successful person. But that's only half the story. While being the best versions of ourselves is key, I believe, to finding happiness and sharing it, the truth is that we are all social beings who thrive on connection. The other half of the story is that we do not exist in our own bubble, but rather communities, families, and the wider universe as a whole. In fact, it's what our seventh principle is all about, respecting the interdependent web to which we all belong. In today's world, where we are increasingly isolated on our devices, the internet, working from home, only seeing each other on Zoom, it can be hard to connect. So how do you go about connecting with the interdependent web? How do you nurture and feed your needs for connection? For me, one of my favorite places to sit is on our deck in our backyard. Our backyard backs onto the neighborhood park. Initially, I didn't think I would like this very much. It's a total lack of privacy, after all, but I love it. I love to sit there in the mornings, drinking my coffee, or late into the evenings around the fire pit. As I wrote this, I was sitting out there, listening to the neighbors' wind chimes, the birds, the wind blowing through the trees, and the leaves rustling. Later on that day, there were soccer teams playing and parents cheering, giggles of the youngsters on the swings, the older teens who congregate on the basketball court, well, their yips, high fives, and thump, thump, thump of the pavement, of the ball hitting the pavement, fills the air. I sit and absorb, listen, and feel. I know none of these people, and yet I am connected to them all. Each of us enjoying some sunshine or fresh air, nature, and the world around us, living life each in our own way. The key is to find beauty in the simple and everyday things that we all experience and that is at the root of all of us. This beauty connects us and makes us similar. Samantha Childs writes in her book, Henry and the Magnificent Snort, a children's book about bullying, belonging, and love, writes, not only are we all unique, we're also connected. Therefore, it makes no sense that you could ever be rejected. Everything and everyone, including you and I, are made up of the magic from the stars and the sky. No one is less, no one is more. We are all exactly the same at the core. Another thing that my family and I have found to do for connectedness is at a local cafe. Every now and then, I will take my three daughters and we will go to White Ave. It's a great place for people watching and to feel the excitement of whatever season lay before us. And we almost always make a stop at Block 1912 Cafe. They have wonderful coffee and desserts, but that is not what brings us here. Rather, is something that is not really well known, a little semi-hidden secret that brings us. Around the cafe, there are lots of comfy couches and chairs, all centered around old coffee tables. And in many of these old coffee tables, there are drawers. And should you be wise enough to open one, you would find that they are filled to the brim with scraps of paper, old napkins, flyers, and coasters, each with a little scribbling or mussing on it. Sometimes that scribbling is a love letter that someone is not ready to say out loud to the object of their affection. Sometimes it's a rant. Sometimes it's someone trying to brighten someone's day or give them a message of hope. Sometimes it's a recipe, a story, a poem, or a drawing. Some are simple or silly. Many are kind of deep. My girls love to read all the anonymous notes. I think they do this because it's their way of connecting with others and realizing they're not alone in their angst or happiness. Often my girls will leave a little note of their own behind, some random mussing or poem, maybe so someone else will know they are not alone in what they are feeling or give a bright side to someone's day. We were there a few weeks ago and I found this gem that spoke to me. Life is long. There is so much time to do everything you dream of. Don't let others tell you that life is too short. Drive slowly. Linger in doorways after saying goodbye. Make sure you allow yourself to enjoy every single day. Do not rush. Savor every moment. Life is long. It's just a random mussing by an anonymous person onto a scrap of paper, and yet it rang for me. It was a reminder to me to slow down and appreciate the small things. What a gift someone left behind to reach out to connect with other random strangers. It was something I guess I needed to read that day. Life is long, my friends. I hope you find the time to slow down, seek out those connections, appreciate the beauty of small things, enjoy life, and know intimately that you are not alone, not ever, that we are connected in our stardust. And now we will have our sharing our abundance. Our community is entirely self-governing and self-supporting. One of the privileges of our free church tradition is to provide all the financial support for our many ministries from among ourselves. Generosity, therefore, is one of the spiritual values that we recognize as central to our personal and institutional well-being. In addition to supporting this church, we also make a monthly commitment beyond our walls. One half of the unidentified cash that is received is given to an outside organization. Some are local, some are national, and some are international. For the month of April, we are sharing our abundance with Child Haven International. Inspired by the ideals and philosophies of Gandhi, Child Haven International is a registered not-for-profit charity founded in 1985. They assist children and women in developing countries who are in need of food, education, health care, shelter, and clothing, emotional and moral support. They ran 8 homes for destitute children in the East, run what I think is a super cool project called the Soya Cow, where they're able to turn soya beans into soya milk quite quickly, and literacy and women's programs to support disadvantaged women to help them become independent and successful. For those in the sanctuary, you can use the envelopes found in the inside cover of our hymn book if you wish to receive a tax receipt for your gift. Please indicate on your envelope your contact information so we can send you a tax receipt at the end of the year. Many of our members and friends give monthly or annually through automatic withdrawal from their accounts. For those of you online, we encourage you to visit the Child Haven International website to make a donation. The offering will now be received. Let's join. We thank you for your generosity and your support. With our time, our talents, and our money, we support the work of community and this Unitarian Universalist tradition. And now we'll move into our meditation.
As we approach a time of contemplation, reflection, meditation, prayer, whatever it is your heart needs at this time, I invite you to take a couple of long, slow, deep breaths. Breathe in with me and out. Let's see if we can hear one another. And then just in your own time, taking a few deep breaths and allowing your body to sink into the chair, the couch, the bed, the floor, wherever you happen to be in the moment that you are hearing my voice. Let gravity pull you. Let yourself know you are being held in this moment, that there's nothing that you have to do right now. You can just be. Let your mind wander. Or try to keep your mind free of the thoughts, naming them as they come, thinking and letting them go, questioning and letting them go, worrying and let it go. Let all that has been troubling you, that has invaded your brain space, your heart, your gut, just for this moment, let it go. I'm taking a couple more breaths and following the breath along. See if you can feel it enter your body. It takes what your body takes from it, what it needs, and lets it go. I invite you into a hand meditation. If you'd like to hold your hands in front of you, always by invitation, never by demand. If you want to watch my hand, with each in-breath, you can trace your finger up, and then with each out-breath, trace your finger down. In, out. I invite you to do that with one or the other of your hands. In and out. In and out. In and out. And then switch hands if you like. And in your own time, and when you have finished, I invite you to give each finger a squeeze. And then as you get to your nail, squeeze it really hard as you let your finger go. Kind of just pop it off. Give each finger a little pressure, and your fingernail a little more. If you like, if it doesn't hurt. If it's what you'd like to do. And in your own time, when you have finished that, I invite you to take your thumb and rub the palm of the opposite hand, like that, if you like, if you want to, if it doesn't hurt. And when you are finished, I invite you to do whatever your hands wish for you to do with them. Lay them on your lap. Give them more squeezes. Shake them out. Whatever they're asking you to do. And then we will just enter into a minute of silence. keeping in the spirit of gentleness and self-nurturing interconnectedness and interdependence, I invite you to come and light candles of joy and of concern. The tables are ready. I invite you now. And as the last candles are being lit, I'm going to ask our service leader, Brandie, to light one last candle, representing all those joys and sorrows and concerns and celebrations that we hold in our hearts, that sometimes, as I've said before, we don't even know they are here with us. Maybe they're hidden from us, and they're yet to be revealed. Gordon's been playing our next hymn, The Oneness of Everything. It's hymn number 1052, thank goodness for the screen. In the teal hymn books, I invite you to arise in body and or in spirit and sing together hymn 1052. I'm a little out of breath. The reading is by Johnny Thompson. We live in a global village of broken barriers and borderless communities. The internet has allowed us to reach across thousands of miles, offering convenience and connection without having to leave the sofa. The problem is that if we spend too long looking out into the distance, we miss what's close at hand. We spend so long on the phone that we forget to talk to those around us. The poet, Gary Snyder, once wrote that we should each aim to get famous within 5 miles. Do not aim to have your name appear in Google searches, but to be known in houses up and down your street or in your back park. Thank you for that. That was a lovely reflection. Meet the neighbors, help fix that fence, go to community meetings, and wave at people in the street. And by Charles Taylor. Individualism names what many people consider to be the finest achievement of modern civilization. We live in a world where people have a right to choose for themselves their own pattern of life, to decide in conscience with what convictions to espouse, to determine the shape of their lives in a whole host of ways that their ancestors couldn't control. The dark side of individualism is a centering on the self, which both flattens and narrows our lives, makes them poorer in meaning and less concerned with others or society. That's the end of the readings. Interdependence versus independent. Being completely independent is actually not possible, is it? For so many obvious reasons. We don't cut down our own wood to make our houses, or mix our own cement to pour our foundations, or grow our own coffee beans that we, for our morning coffee, which I am so grateful for, the elixir of life in the morning. And sometimes we even get them in a drive-thru, and so can you imagine the thousands of people we are dependent upon, the multiple conglomerates that it takes to put together so that we can go through a drive-thru to get our coffee and maybe a breakfast sandwich. Personally, I make my own coffee in the morning in my beloved Breville Barista Express. And I would like to acknowledge my privilege in being able to own a Breville Barista Express. In the world of quantum physics, it is also quite impossible to be completely independent. And I know what you're thinking. There she goes talking about quantum physics again, and she knows nothing about quantum physics, and you're absolutely right. I know nothing about quantum physics, and it fascinates me. So I keep talking about it. We can't show up anywhere. Quantum tells us without changing things around us. What is meant by that is, if we take the example of just coming here to church on Sunday morning, your presence changes the experience for everyone else present that shows up. So if you weren't here, everyone else wouldn't have the same experience. Think about that for a sec. It's kind of like, huh? You can't just sneak in, sit at the back, and dash off after the service without affecting the outcome of the service, as well as affecting the experience of everyone here, whether you realize it or not. Quantum also tells us that you can't actually observe anything without having to change, without changing the thing you're observing. So if there are any actual physicists or cosmologists here, I, as I have said, know nothing about this, and I beg your forgiveness at my simplification of this very complex concept. The science behind the studies that determined that we can't observe a thing without changing the thing is in the realm of spooky quirks and quarks, to use the name of a familiar and popular CBC radio series that has ended, which sadly. Apparently, there are things called waves and particles we can't see with our eyes, and they can be observed under the microscope, though. If the scientists watching the waves and the particles decide that they want the particles to act like waves, if they want the things to act like waves, they will act like waves. And if the scientists are looking for particles, they will act like particles. It's kind of spooky, isn't it? So the thing, the little wee tiny thing that we can't see with our eyes, if we decide we want it to be a particle, it will act like a particle. And if we decide we want it to be a wave, it will act like a wave. Therefore, the conclusion is we can't observe anything without changing it. So, for an example, a kind of a huge, kind of clumsy example, If you all came here and decided that the service was going to be boring and awkward, and sat with grim faces and your arms crossed, kind of scowling at me, I would get pretty nervous up here, and I would become really awkward, and the sermon would be really awful. It's kind of like a fulfilling prophecy, right? If, on the other hand, you were leaning in, smiling, laughing, joining in, participating, clapping, perhaps even clapping on 2 and 4, and allowing yourself to move to the music, you would go away feeling like you had gotten something out of this service. Your observation and attitude changed the outcome. Again, a very clumsy and not microscopic example. I'd like to say it again, though. Your presence here on Sunday morning changes the experience for everyone else in the congregation that is also here. It can't help but. We are interdependent creatures. Our energy mixes and mingles with everyone else's energy, and we can't help but co-create. Margaret J. Wheatley, in her book Leadership and the New Science, Discovering Order in a Chaotic World, states, "The quantum mechanical view of reality startles us out of common notions of what is real. Even to scientists, it is admittedly bizarre. In the quantum world, relationship is the key determiner of everything. Subatomic particles come into form and are observed only as they are in relationship to something else. They do not exist as independent things." End of quote. We could take from this that there is actually no such thing as independence, that everything is interdependent, for even subatomic particles don't exist outside of relationship. When I worked with children who were unable to manage in a regular classroom, the teacher that I worked with used to say, "Nothing happens outside of a relationship." And she'd say, "Don't even try to teach them anything before Christmas. Before Christmas, all you want to do is build a relationship with these kids." We had 8 students, and there was herself and myself in the classroom with these 8 students. So that's a pretty low ratio of kids, so I'm just going to leave it to your imagination, some of the work that we were doing in that classroom. As I did that, as I just built relationships with them and did not expect them to do their math sheets or didn't try to teach them anything, trust and rapport began to build. Before that, before Christmas, if I had told them to do something, they wouldn't have heeded me. It was only after we had built that trust and rapport. So these are just 2 examples of how the idea of separateness is folly, and that we are connected, whether we like it or not. Quantum physics makes my head swim. I don't know about yours, but it makes mine swim. So let's just take a breath. Let's just take a breath and enjoy a moment of musical interlude from Danylo while we think about what we've heard and the idea of your presence changes the experience for everyone else here. So if you weren't here, it wouldn't be as good for everyone else. Just think about that as we listen to Danylo play "River Flows in You."
Thank you.
A quote from Francis Weller. Physiotherapist Miriam Greenspan uses the term intervulnerability to describe the need for this mutually held space. When asked about this idea in an interview, she replied, "When I say we are intervulnerable, I mean we suffer together, whether consciously or unconsciously." Albert Einstein called the idea of a separate self an optical delusion of consciousness. Martin Luther King Jr. said that we are all connected in an inescapable web of mutuality. There's no way out, though we try to escape by armoring ourselves against pain and in the process diminishing our lives and our consciousness. But in our intervulnerability is our salvation. Because awareness of this mutuality of suffering impels us to search for ways to heal the whole rather than encase ourselves in a bubble of denial and impossible individualism. At this point in history, it seems that we will either destroy ourselves or find a way to build a sustainable life together. I'll say that again. At this point in history, it seems that we will either destroy ourselves or find a way to build a sustainable life together. I am born of good Saskatchewan settler stock on both sides of my family. My mother's parents homesteaded in the Maple Creek area in southern Saskatchewan, fairly near Cypress Hills, and my father's family homesteaded northeast of Saskatoon in the fertile Carrot River Valley near Nakum. Neighbors were few and far between. Earning a living was hard, and the weather was harsh. Neighbors knew each other and relied on each other for their very existence. Literally relied on each other for their very existence. It was easier to see then the interdependence, the fact that they couldn't live without the support given one another and the hands of friendship extended. Things aren't really so different now, really. We need support from others to make it through. However, our neighbors could be in California picking our strawberries, or our friends could be across the world and we see them in a magical Zoom room. Our needs haven't changed. How we get our needs met has changed though, hasn't it? The human touch has disappeared and multimedia giants are telling us what to buy. I was reading in the New York Times this morning how so many of these things that you might find that pop up on your feed in either an Instagram or X or Facebook, and it's like, oh, this buy this wonderful, wonderful thing. And there's a whole bunch of influencers that say, oh, I bought it and I got it and it was wonderful, that they're giving fake reviews, enticing us to buy this big, wonderful thing. So don't believe those things. I was quite surprised. I sometimes get sucked in. And then I'm like, oh, I hope it hasn't happened to you as well. So the multimedia giants are telling us over and over what to buy and then tricking us into buying them and how we need all of the things to be happy and that we mustn't share. Communal kitchens and laundries are a thing of the past. Have you heard the story of a well-meaning organization going into a small village in a very remote part of Africa or India? This is just off the top of my head. And they put a well in the village because the women had to walk a far way to get the water and to wash their clothes. And so the women kind of ignored the well and continued to walk together to get the water and to wash the clothes in the river. And the organizers were baffled. Why would they do that? We've created this space and all they have to do is leave their homes, get the water, it's easy. Well, the women got away from the men, right? And they got to walk a long way. and they got to visit. Maybe it wasn't too long, but they got to visit and hang out together and tell stories and look after one another's children and love one another. It was, and visit cheerfully. I don't know the details of the story or how the outcome was, but it's kind of a familiar story, and the point is clear. We need one another, and there are becoming fewer and fewer places where we gather in community. Recreation centers, community leagues, senior centers are also valuable resources for relationships. When I asked last week what important thing you have gained from being part of UCE, the first thing people I heard people saying over and over again, friends, friendship, having someone to hang out with, going to a movie with, building relationships. Others, we gain insight into ourselves. We find ways to serve. And having some of our needs met are all reasons to come to church, whether it's here or another church. Being together in a covenantal community means that we can learn how to be the best we can be. And we do all that within the context of diversity. People of all ages, of all interests and social status. So what's so different about coming here and maybe belonging to a gym, which is also a good thing? Well, for starters, you don't get to sing at the gym. You might get to listen to music, but you don't get to sing. Folks at the senior centers aren't going to wonder how it is with your spirit, perhaps. Or maybe they will. Or wish to work together with you on a project. Maybe they will. Here, we are interdependently working together to try to build a healthy, loving community where we can hopefully make the world a better place. And we can certainly be working on making ourselves better. We need gyms and senior centers and community leagues too. That's for sure. Just like those settlers and many living today, we need one another if we are going to survive. One of the things that struck me when I got here is how much work you put in to create this space. You worked interdependently to make something beautiful. Let's continue the tradition of working together, creating something beautiful and worthwhile. We have something wonderful to offer to one another, our presence. For it is our very presence that changes everything for everyone around us. I wonder how interdependence is going to play out here at UCE as we continue to get all the things in place to create safer space and to have a bedrock foundation. I wonder what the next great thing is you might want to do. We work interdependently with one another. Just like a good potluck dinner. Magic happens when we all do our part. So may it be, and amen. I invite you to sing together our closing hymn, Lean on Me, hymn number 1021. I invite you to rise in body and or in spirit and to not be afraid to sing and sway and clap on 2 and 4.
We are made, we all have souls.
you. We always do that one so well. Thank you to Reverend Rosemary for her sermon today, and it kind of reminded me of a quote I heard or a story I heard recently, and I'm just ad-libbing this, sorry, it's not planned, with the quantum physics whole thing, is that, you know, the movies, Back to the Future, has taught us quite a bit that we worry that if we were to time travel and make one small change, it would have a drastic effect on the future, and yet nobody really stops to consider that anything that we do today could also have the same effect. So I leave that. We will now have Extinguishing the Flame, and I will ask Jeff to come up and extinguish it, please. This one is called The Work We Share by Krista Taz. It is our work, shared with each other in covenant, that creates and sustains this beloved community. We extinguish this chalice, but its light lives on in the directions we have chosen today. The light of this faith lives on in us together, in our hearts, minds, bodies, and spirits. Amen, and blessed be.
Just in case I forget it again, I have it with me. I apologize for that for last week. I was sure I had it. Before I offer words of benediction to you, I would like to thank everyone that has been involved with the service, participation, putting it on. Thank you so much for your great service leading. I would like to especially like Danylo for, just give us a minute, I would especially like to Danylo for coming. Yeah, you can stay standing. Danylo arrived in Canada not too terribly long ago and was Audrey Brooks, who we all know and love, was her first folks that stayed with them. And Audrey started teaching Danylo piano when they got here and has kind of taken off. So I just like to give you a warm welcome and a warm thank you. And right after I do the benediction, you'll be playing the postlude. And the postlude is Amelie. Okay. And so, I invite you to go in hope. For the arc of the universe is long, and we can bend it toward justice. And I invite you to go in strength. For together we have the strength I invite you to go in courage, for together we have the strength to confront injustice in our daily lives. And I invite you to go in love, for a holy and generous love is both the reason and the means by which we transform our world. Go in peace, gentle people, go in peace. And now our postlude, after which we will sing Carry the Flame.
Thank you.
And Gordon, could you lead us in Carry the Flame, please? I invite you to join, and you don't have to hold hands. I'm not coming anywhere near you, so...